biblical rhetoric of curiacial subordination still shapes our religious and political imagination. Hence, I want to discuss in this lecture the next text of subordination inscribed in Christian scriptures. These texts have shaped and continue to shape contemporary political imagination and practices. Today's public political debates about marriage and family often appeal not only to concepts such as human rights and sexual ethics, but also to the biblical foundation of the American institution of marriage. Such appeals present heterosexual marriage as an unchanging institution that has simply always been so as it is today. Moreover, they neglect the articulation both they neglect to articulate both the centrality of power relations to discussions of marriage and the ways in which these discussions survive in the present. Against this backdrop, we will examine the political understandings of marriage and household present in early Christian writings and the roles that such understandings play in the formation of early Christian communities. This language of subordination is shaped by the two dominant political institutions of the first century, the Roman Empire, Basileia, and the democratic assembly of the Greek city-state, the Ecclesia. Both are key terms in Christian scriptures. If the Bible is understood as the word of God or as a cultural classic, it can be used in the interest of domination. Hence, it is important to evaluate how its texts reproduce the power of domination and subordination inscribed in scriptures. To bring notions of scripture and politics together can have an irritating, upsetting, and disturbing effect and jar religious imaginations and sensibilities. Moreover, insofar as scripture is also claimed to be the liberating word of a just and loving God, the rhetoric of liberation appears contradictory to and incongruent with a scriptural rhetoric that advocates domination and subordination. And yet both the imperial language of domination and its violence and the democratic language of communal love are encoded in Christian scriptures. They have shaped not only religious but also cultural self-understanding and ethos throughout the centuries and still so today. Such language of subordination and control does not just belong to a forgotten historical past. Rather, as language of scripture, it is performative language that determines not only Christian, but also American and Mexican identity and praxis. In a short essay in Time magazine, Deborah Tannen, a feminist scholar of linguistics, has pointed during the past election day in the US to the double bind that a woman presidential candidate like Hillary Clinton appears to have and why she appears to be inauthentic and not trustworthy. I quote, a double bind means you must obey two commands, but anything you do to fulfill one violates the other. While the requirements of a good leader and a good man are similar, the requirements of a good leader and a good woman are mutually exclusive. The most difficult aspect of the double bind is that it is invisible. We think we are just reacting to the candidates as individuals, yet even the words to talk about women are drenched in gender. End of quote. One of the cultural roots of this double bind is, as I said, Christian scripture. Since allusions to Christian scriptures are still used in public discourses today, the language of domination continues to be encoded in Western democratic political understandings of masculinity, while the language of mutuality and community has become privatized as feminine and as religion. Moreover, right-wing religious movements around the globe have insisted in the past decades on the figuration of emancipated women as signifiers of modern atheistic secularism and have presented masculine power as the expression of divine power. The interconnections between religious anti-democratic arguments and the debate with regard to women's place and role in church, home, and society is not accidental, nor is it merely a matter of intra-religious significance. Thus, we need a hermeneutical lens that can detect this cultural double bind promulgated by religious scriptures and make it conscious publicly. Hence, a critical political feminist approach to scripture engages a doubled analysis, one that conceptualizes power vertically as structural pyramidal relations of dominations, and one that understands power horizontally as an ideological network of relations of domination. Both modes of imperial power, the vertical and the horizontal, are at work in capitalist globalization. Both the vertical power pyramid of domination and the horizontal ideological network are structured by race, gender, sexuality, class, empire, age, religion, and others, which are intersecting systems of curiarchal power. These structures of curiarchal power have multiplicative effects of dehumanizing and exploitation and other subordinations. Hence, it is necessary to distinguish the sacred liberative power of scripture from the power of domination that also has shaped Christian scriptures. This is possible because power can be seen and exercised not only as power over, as power of domination and rule, as control and command, as the power of domination. Power can also be a source of politicized power for and power to. It is the capacity, energy, and potential. Power is creative, energizing, enabling, and transformative. It is creative activity and strength. Thus, power can be understood as something wielded by the few to dominate the many, or it can be seen as energizing everyone, as an enriching creative possibility for community and justice. If power always has this dual connotation, then we must adjudicate within a process of evaluation what kind of power each scriptural text authorizes. Since Christian scriptures share in the rhetoric of power over or in that of power to. This observation compels us to raise the question as to whether a particular scriptural text advocates the power of domination, which demands submission, subordination, and subjection, or whether it articulates forms of creative, energizing, and enabling power to resist injustice and global exploitation. In light of these two definitions of power, Scripture can be mobilized as power over, in terms of the imperial command submission structure, or it can be searched for enabling and energizing power for the creation of community and justice. We find a series of texts in the Christian Testament that demand submission to the Kyrios, a term that refers to the emperor as well as to the head of household, the Lord, slave master, and father. That is to the elite, propertied male, as we have discussed in the morning. These texts are classified as household codes, a label derived from Lutheran teaching on social status and roles. Such household or domestic codes are found in the so-called Deuteropauline, Pastoral, and Catholic epistles. The basic form of these household code texts consists of three pairs of exhortation, addressing the relationship between wife and husband, children and fathers, slaves and masters. In each case, the socially subordinate first member of the pair is exhorted to obedience to the superordinate second. In short, household code texts are concerned with seemingly three sets of relationship: wife and husband, slave and master, and children and fathers. However, it must not be overlooked that in each case it is the Kyrios, the head of the household, to whom the members of the household owe submission. The central interest of these texts is to bolster the authority of the Kyrios by demanding submission and obedience from the socially weaker group, wives, slaves, slave women, children, and the whole community. The earliest form of these so-called household codes in the Christian Testament is found in the letter to the Colossians, in Colossians 3:18-4:1. This text reads, "Wives, be subject to your husbands, as is fitting in the Lord, Kyrios. Husbands, love your wives and never treat them harshly. Children, obey your parents in everything, for this is your acceptable duty in the Lord. Fathers, do not provoke your children, or they may lose heart. Slaves, obey your earthly masters in everything, not only while being watched and in order to please them, but wholeheartedly, fearing the Lord, curious. Whatever your task, put yourself into it as done for the Lord and not for your masters. Since you know that from the Lord you will receive the inheritance as your reward, you serve the Lord Christ. For the wrongdoer will be paid back for whatever wrong has been done, and there is no partiality. Masters, treat your slaves justly and fairly, for you know that you also have a master in heaven. This Christian Testament or New Testament teaching on male headship and female subordination reflects the oikos, or the household ideal, of the Roman Empire that calls for submission and subjection from members of the household, officers of the empire, citizens of Rome, and of the provinces. It does not just affect elite married men and women and their relationships, but it calls for submission and subordination of all the subjects of the Roman Empire. Freeborn men and women, slave women and men, clients and resident aliens. However, it must not be overlooked that these texts are not descriptive texts, but they are prescriptive. They probably are responses to the egalitarian ethos of the Ecclesia, which is best translated not as church, but as democratic assembly that met in house this oikoi. Once again, it is important to bear in mind that these texts are not only concerned with three sets of household relationships, wife and husband, slave and master, and children and parents, but also with submission to the emperor. The central interest of these texts lies in enforcing patterns of submission and obedience of socially weaker groups. The whole community, wives, slaves, and children, on the one hand, and in bolstering the authority of the head of household, the curious, the paterfamilias, on the other. In the case of the emperor, this would have encompassed the whole empire. To destabilize the household was then a threat to the order of the state, or the order of the curiacal order. This pattern of domination and subjection need not always include the four social status groups: freeborn male heads of households, slave women, wives, and children, addressed in the Epistle to the Colossians. In other texts, only some of the subordinate groups are mentioned. Most importantly, these are not just household codes, but imperial codes that demand obedience to the political powers of the Roman Empire. Such texts are used to ensure the ethos of submission, not only for the household, but also for the Christian community, that is understood as household of God. Such injunctions to submissiveness occur already in the authentic Pauline letters, for example, in Romans 13 or in to the state, or in 1 Corinthians 14. While this pattern of subordination functions differently in different early Christian documents and their social, ecclesial, historical contexts, the imperial pattern of submission seems to be characteristic for the pattern. This pattern of submission conceives not only of family, but also of state and Christian community in terms of the curiacal household. Familia in the Roman Empire did not mean nuclear family. Rather, it encompassed all those who were under the authority of the pater familias. The household or domus is included all those affiliated visit and included clients, day workers, and even visitors. The household in the Roman Empire was an economic production center, a central site of education and training in trade and craft skills, a guarantor of social services, and the locus of religious life. Politically, the household was a microcosm of the empire and the nursery of the state. As Cicero, a Roman philosopher and politician who lived in the first century before Christ, so succinctly states, the first bond of union is that between husband and wife, the next that between parents and children. Then we find one domus with everything in common. And this is the foundation of civil government, the nursery, as it were, of the state. The emperor was called Pater Patrum, father of the fathers, and Pater Patriae, the father of the fatherland. The emperor was the ultimate father and lord, Kyrios, par excellence. He was king of kings and lord of lords. According to Greco-Roman political ideology, a male citizen's authority rested in his dominance over his extended household. Those male citizens who could not control their households risked losing control of the state. Hence, the emperor, like any other elite male, had to project and maintain a firm image of patriarchal control. He had to appear to be in full control of his household in order to show that he was to be trusted as ruler of the empire. To quote the Roman historian Price, the stability of the imperial rule was perceived to lie in the transmission of power within the imperial family, and in consequence, considerable importance was attached to the whole imperial house. If one reads the household code in the letter to the Ephesians, in this Roman political imperial context, the letter is a highly political language comes to the fore. Not only is God the cosmic pater familias, the father of the family, the father from whom all fatherland, patria flows, but also Christ Messiah, who takes this role in place of the emperor. The author elaborates the household in terms of the relationship between Christ and the Ecclesia. Ecclesia is a feminine noun. While it is typically translated as church, in most modern translation, the term Ecclesia might be better translated as democratic decision-making assembly. The establishment of the Roman Empire in Asia Minor brought the Greek democratic citizen government in the form of the Ecclesia into tension and conflict with the imperial political power of Rome. Read within this political frame, the author seems to favor imperial power over citizen power, when he argues that, like the Ecclesia, wives too should be subordinate. However, such imperial kyriarchal power should be exercised in agape love. I quote Ephesians, "Wives, be subject to your husbands as you are to the Lord. For the husband is the head of the wife, just as Christ is the head of the church, the body, of which he is the Savior. Just as the church is subject to Christ, so all the wives ought to be in everything to their husbands."